I'm happy to have my wife Peggy with me today, who does not like to get introduced to these. There she is, right there. Some of y'all may have heard me tell the story, but I'll tell it again. I was on the way to a national convention, a Republican convention, a few months ago, and I said to Peggy, did you ever in your wildest dream, imagine me nominating Donald Trump for president at the Republican convention in Ohio, Cleveland, Ohio? She said, Henry, I hate to tell you, but I've never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. I guess 30 or 40 years ago, if we'd looked at where we are now, we'd say that we would never in our wildest dreams see South Carolina perched right on the edge of the greatest prosperity that we've ever imagined as we are today. From what I see, there's nothing that can hold us back unless we impose too many regulations or raise taxes or do something that inhibits the freedom and the growth of the people. We've got to be very careful we don't mess it up. And I'll quote a lady, y'all remember the governor of New Jersey, Christy Todd Whitman, who served as the head of the EPA under one of the first President Bush, I think, for 8 years. We were up at the Capital City Club a few years ago at some sort of a dinner. We were looking out the window, and it's just beautiful. You can see the football stadium and the university down there, and all the people and buildings going up, and hell, cranes around here and there, and the greenery, and it's just gorgeous. And I was telling her about how South Carolina had so much potential, as all of us saw it and all that. And she says, yes, you really do. She said, I hope you don't mess it up. So as I see it, that's about the way it is now. What we have to do is be sure we don't mess it up, be sure we don't put the brakes on it. And if we do that, we are heading for prosperity that's going to shake the world. I think we can be a model for the whole country in the things we do. This, our state's different from other states. One thing is, everybody knows everybody. In fact, most people related to half the people you see most everybody. I remember one fella I asked one time, he said, my question is, if we married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? But that's the real advantage. That means we can turn on a dime. And our legislature, all of our political leaders, all our business leaders, all know each other and able to get together and to turn on a dime to accommodate the new things that are coming. And here's the one message, the one point I want to get you to think about that's occurred to me in the last few years since really watching the Senate. I had the great pleasure of watching the debates on all kind of issues in the Senate for 2 years as Lieutenant Governor. And really quite an educational experience. A lot of people in there who know what they're talking about. And it's a privilege to really be able to listen to them and try to learn. But it seems to me that something has happened here that's also happened around the world, and some of these big companies that we have in the state can tell you this because they've told me that, did this, what I'm telling you just recently. And that is the world has changed. In South Carolina, we used to have the two big groups of workers with the unskilled labor and then those with the four-year college degrees. And then you needed a postgraduate degree. So you had the unskilled, a lot of entry-level work, young people working. Doesn't require a lot of skill, some training. But you also had your academic requirements on a big group of the rest. And in the middle, there were a lot of jobs, but it's nothing like it is today. Today, that middle group has just expanded. Just as the invention of fracking, as you know, has changed our dependence on foreign oil. It's changed the world. We don't realize how the impact that that's had on the security of our country and the security of the world, because it's not eliminated, but it's reduced our dependence on foreign oil. Those people over in the Middle East are so much, so it's one reason gas prices are low. It's one reason that we don't hear from them, except in about other things. You remember the embargo back in the 70s. Remember how tough that was? Well, we're not going to have that anymore. We can't have it anymore because of the changes that have taken place. Well, also the changes have taken place in our workforce. And most of those changes are reflected in what you've got in your pocket. And that's this thing right here. I mean, that's just changed everything. I saw a demonstration. Where's Canute? Is he here from Mercedes? They were showing the other day one of their vehicles is coming out in the future. They had a van that was a beautiful streamlined van, if you can imagine a UPS, a FedEx vehicle, you know how they load them up and then unload one at a time, take the packages out. Well, those days are numbered, because now they load a rack in the, or will be doing this, load a rack that's in the warehouse that is loaded by a bunch of robots. And somebody backs the truck up in, and they open it up, and it's all the way open, and they just push the rack in there and close the door. That's about all the human has to do. And then get in the vehicle and start driving. It'll tell him where to go. And as he's going along, the flap will open on the roof, and one of the two drones will come over, reach down, get a package, and take it to your house. And then the other drone will get a package and take it to your house. And then the driver will get out and drop the package off at somebody's front door. And then he'll get in and drive on down the street, and the drones will be coming in and taking packages, coming in and taking. Things have changed. And what that means is that this workforce in the middle that does not require the academic qualifications that we used to all chase after and want to have, and it requires more than the unskilled labor, has just grown phenomenally. And so what that does is that puts the focus right on the technical skills that we produce in our technical college, and also is produced by a new program called Be Proud. It's a great program, you might see it around, and that is emphasizing the importance of those jobs and the good pay that comes with those jobs. And I heard a story the other day about a young fella who was down on his luck. Somebody took him on his wing and talked him into going and getting his GED. So he got his GED and he said, you ought to go to tech school. He went to tech school and he got his either a welder's certificate or a welder's associate degree. I think they have both. I don't know what the difference is, but he got one of those. And he went out, and I think his starting salary was somewhere upwards of $60,000, maybe close to $70,000. And then he decided to go back and get a nuclear welding certificate. And when all that was done, just within a space of about 4 years, he'd gone from nothing to making around $100,000 a year. Well, there are all kind of jobs like that. And let me just go through a few of them to give you an idea. This is this great group of jobs. And our job, I think, is to teach. We got to change the culture where people believe that it is a good thing to be doing this highly skilled labor. It takes talent, it takes skill, it takes technical knowledge, it takes brain power. It takes all those things, but it does not require the time and expense of a four-year degree, an academic degree of that kind. You just don't need it anymore. But all the parents want their children to have such a thing. And a PhD is even better. And you do need those for something. But they say the PhD, that leads to expertise, and an expert is someone who knows more and more about less and less until they know all there is to know about nothing. So here's some of these jobs. Be Pro, Be Proud is looking for these. And let me mention, it used to be we had people looking for jobs. Now we got jobs looking for people. There are about 60,000 jobs out there right now, these kind I'm going to read to you, that are unfilled and that people are looking for them. Here you go, commercial truck driver. They're commercial truck drivers that make $100,000 a year. And I can just see the young man, a young woman going, and the mom and dad said, well, son, you need to go to school, get that four-year degree in this or that, and make us proud. I said, well, Dad, how much are you making now? You getting ready to retire? I said, I'm right up $55,000. How about you, son? I said, it was a commercial truck driver. In 2 years, I'll be making $100,000. Somebody needs to deliver that message. And that somebody, of course, is us. Here you go. Commercial truck driver, HVAC technician, plumber, electrician, carpenter, a diesel technician, CNC operator, tool and die maker, machinist, CAD-CAM drafter, computer programmer, welder, I already mentioned nuclear welder. Also, automotive technology, agri-science, architectural design technology, advanced computer animation, biotechnology laboratory technician, nuclear medicine technology, surgical technician, cybersecurity, aircraft assembly technology, robotics technology, I mentioned that a moment ago, nuclear quality engineering principle. I don't know what that is, but I guarantee you it pays some money. So what we have to do is tell the people there's a new paradigm there. If you want an academic four-year degree, that's great. And you can you can achieve that. We got lots of schools, there's scholarships, a lot of businesses give scholarships. But if you don't want to do that, if you would rather go do something that you really want to do, there's some people that really want to drive a truck. There are some people that really want to build things. There's some people that like to get in and perfect these engines and all of this complicated technical equipment. I was out at the airport getting, State has two planes. I was getting on one of them and they had the cowling off the other and the engine was exposed. And there were two men over there working in it, had all these sophisticated tools. I had no idea what the tools were, they were working. So I asked, what do you call that you're doing? And that was some sort of aeronautical engineering something. I said, that's pretty good. What is the average salary of someone, or the average pay of someone doing what you're doing right now? He said, in South Carolina, yes, $75,000 a year. You go home at 5 o'clock? Yes. Okay. So what we have to do is send the message, is teach the people that there's great pride, it takes great skill, it takes brain power to do this work, and that there are plenty of jobs out there. And all they have to do is apply themselves. If you want a lady to go back and finish up that four-year degree, that's fine. But get on out there and start making some money right now. Raise a family, be proud of yourself, and let's get these jobs coming to this state and strengthen these great companies, large and small, that we have in this state. See, I have figured it out. People always know, well, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? The chicken or the egg? I'll tell you what comes first is the job. The job comes first. When we have good paying jobs for people that they enjoy, the kind of things that they want to do, when we can offer that in South Carolina, what that means is the domestic violence rate goes down. The divorce rate goes down. The marriage rate goes up. Drug usage goes down. People smile more. They buy more clothes. Everything prospers when people have work. So in an audience like this, where everybody is deeply involved in exactly what we're celebrating today, I want you to help us take this message to the people that it's available, and we got to teach the young people. Things have changed. You can use your brain power on something that does not necessarily require a four-year degree. And my friends from universities and colleges, don't worry, there will be plenty of students that still want to come. But in the meantime, we have an enormous opportunity. There's not another state in the Southeast that can keep up with us. They're all looking at South Carolina because they're marveling at what was going on. And what I'm speaking of about having that gap in the workforce, it's not just in South Carolina, it's not just in the country, it's all over the world. But nobody else in the world has all the assets we have. The research universities, technical colleges, great port, electrical power, water, all the things that we have. So we can really, right now, we have a great opportunity. And I love to see these young people that are stepping into this great world with these great ideas and innovation. And that just proves if we do it right now, the next generation and the one after them, they'll build on what we've done just as we're building on those that went before. And South Carolina will be stronger, stronger, stronger.